Thank you all for having me today, and it is a pleasure to be speaking with the Panhandle Patriots. I have a deep, warm feeling for all of you guys as being part of the organization, and this is where everything started. So it was really a pleasure to be able to announce to all of you that I'm running for office here as well. We have a big problem in America, and I'm sure that you all know what it is. We're fighting two enemies. We are not only fighting the globalists who feel, just as Andre said, that we should be part of the United Nations, but we are also fighting the Muslims who feel that by 2015, they will fly the Muslim flag over the White House. And for those of you that do not realize, Barack Obama is a Muslim no matter what he says, because in the Muslim religion, the father dictates the religion of the children, and his father was a Muslim. In the Jewish religion, the mother dictates the religion of the children. My mother was Jewish, therefore I would be Jewish. He is a Muslim, his father was a Muslim. That's the way it works, and nothing changes. So we have a twofold problem because the person living in the White House is not only a globalist, but he is also a Muslim. What are they after, and what do they want? Well, as Andre said, they want to control us. And they want us to be part of their global plan, which is one world government with a new world order. And they go by a lot of acronyms, but mostly they're being known now as NWO. What we have to realize is that through this plan of Agenda 21, which is really a reproduction of an older plan, and we'll talk about that for a minute later on, but through this plan, they have laid out a mechanism to control every aspect of humanity by incorporating their three items, although I say there are four. And they control us by incorporating equity, which is us, ourselves, our land, our people, whatever is our private property, into the environment, along with economics. And in order for them to control us, they must control all of those items. And that's why Barack Obama has spent the last 4 years putting in place numerous executive orders that will nationalize industry and destroy small business. So every time he goes out and he says how wonderful the middle class is and how he's fighting for the middle class, I want you to think he's lying, because he is, because he has no desire to help the middle class, because globalists only believe in a two-class system, those that have and those that have not. And they feel that we should have not. So everything is connected. Nothing ever happens at random. The only thing that might happen at random would be a weather event. Everything happens for a reason, and everything is based on lies. And that's the sad part. For the last 60 years, we have been lied to over and over and over again. We talk about they. Who are they? Well, this is really they. And they are part of numerous groups. They are part of the Illuminati, the International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, a variety of governments, monarchs, the Bilderbergs, the Club of Rome, the Trilateral Commission, the Council of Foreign Relations, and on the Muslim side, they are part of the Organization of Islamic States, of which there are 57 states. Did you hear that before? Yes. That's where it came from. Now, if I took this chart and I put it away and I said, okay, today we are going to talk about fossil fuel. Let's see, who would we talk to? Surprise. If I put this away and I said, today we're going to talk about education, who would we talk to? Same people. Nothing changes. It is always the same people over and over and over again. And they play with our money They want our land and our resources. And America is the last stronghold. Their goal is money, control, and power. And the last thing they're working on right now is the power part. And how do they get millions of people to believe them? They lie. Very simple. It was funny, the other day I was talking to someone and he said, you know, Karen, I went to another meeting and there was a man there and he was talking about Agenda 21 and he said the exact same thing that you did. He didn't change one thing. And I said, funny thing about the truth, there's only one version. And when you know it, you can't unknow it. And when you know it, you can't change it because it's the truth. Over the years, people like G. Gary Lawrence, who was a communications director for Bill Clinton, made statements that said that if the American people knew that this was a plan emanating from the United Nations, they would throw it out. So what did they do? They gave it a new name. And what name did they give it? Well, there's a list on the bottom of that chart that is a variety of names that they use that are interchangeable to get to the same goal. At a press conference, David Rockefeller told the press conference to thank them very much, the media, for keeping this hidden for 40 or more years so they could get all of their plans in place. So years ago when the John Birch Society and G. Edward Griffin and Dr. Kaufman and Michael Shaw were screaming that this was happening and they were being told that they had tinfoil hats, this was happening. And everything that we have said over the last several years is now coming true. The good news is the people are beginning to get it. And that's what they are afraid of. And right now, they are extremely fearful. They work best on divide and conquer. And when you go through this book, you will find that every single category of human being is in there. And they separate people into different categories, basically because they don't want people to talk to each other. That's their biggest issue. Because if people begin to talk, they will realize that what they are being told is about a bunch of lies. So what they do is keep the people separate. And you can see that on surveys that you fill out. It says, are you white? What is your race? What is your religion? What is your gender? So I started now doing my race. I put other. I'm an American. When it says, sex, I write yes. When it says religion, I put other. It's nobody's business. And that is our issue. It is nobody's business. But if we don't start taking back the power, they will get it. Power is a very elusive thing. You can only have power over someone if they let you. And when we say no, as we just did with Tony Bennett, as they are doing with the 750 plan, guess what? Well, they go back and they try to refigure it out. And they can't figure out why people aren't buying into their garbage. And that's because we're onto them. The problem is we're dealing with a lot of mid-level people who have gotten their orders from them. So this is the big issue. I believe that Florida is still being run and controlled by Jeb Bush, the Bush family, the gift that keeps on giving. We have to be very careful when we look at candidates, and we need to get behind real people and stop looking at the parties, because one of the other things that I also will show you is that both parties are the same. How do they do this? Well, when I was in college and when I went to school, I was in New York, and I got involved in all of this. So in my former life, I was a liberal Democrat, and I went to their meetings, and I learned how to psychologically manipulate people in the classroom because I was going to be a teacher. And my direction of manipulation was supposed to be towards my students. When I started teaching, I began to realize that the books that I was using in my current class were not the books that I had when I went to school. So I dug out my old books, and I started working with that from my classes. And my principal would walk in the room on a continual basis and say, "Ms. Schoen, you're not teaching from the curriculum." And I would turn to him and say, "And if my children fail, you can fire me, or better yet, I will leave." And my kids got awards every time at graduation. And I always chose the worst class, and I worked in the worst school. And I did that on purpose, because every child can learn. Socioeconomic garbage does not have anything to do with a person's intelligence. Every child has something that they hold dear, that once you find, you can teach them anything, and they will learn everything. All you have to do is be willing to listen. One size shoe fits all does not work, does not go anywhere, and certainly should never be in our schools. So they work on all types of different manipulation programs, and we and our children are the results of those experiments. And they have combined the media with Hollywood, and you can see and you can hear. And I actually went back and I started watching some TV shows that I had stopped because I was so turned off, because I wanted to see if what I had uncovered in the 80s was being continued. And sure enough, there it was. The messages: if you watch a show, don't watch a show for the storyline. Watch the show for the secondary storyline, because it is the secondary storyline that is continued over and over again through a variety of programming. And I'll show you what it means. There's a dish commercial out, and the beginning of the dish commercial says, "When you get your cable bill, you feel powerless." Why on earth would anybody feel powerless at getting a cable bill? Okay? How many times I was sitting and counting, how many times in that commercial were they telling the people they feel powerless? It takes the average person 10 times to hear something before it registers. 4 times in the commercial, they use the term, "You feel powerless." And then I went to the show, which happened to be a Law and Order show, and right in that show, 3 times, they used the words, "They felt powerless." By the end of that show, that person who is trained in through psychological manipulation will begin to feel powerless. And that's the way the manipulation works. Today, 87% of the children, and they don't call them children, they call them human capital. 80% of our human capital feels that it is the government's job to take care of them. How did that happen? Because they are told they are powerless. And what we have to realize is we are not. Now, why did they choose America? What was so special? Why is this hoopla over America? Several reasons. One, in America, all people are born equally. Now, that does not mean we all should have an equal outcome. What that means is we have an equal opportunity. And by being educated properly, we should be able to choose and select using our skills of logic, reason, and critical thinking. But if you're not taught that in school, then you have no logic, reason, and critical thinking, and then you feel powerless, which is what this is all about. Their goal is our wealth. The middle class cannot have wealth, because wealth treats people unfairly, they will say. And that is what social justice is. There's a very big difference between social justice, which is being taught in school, and equal justice, which is what America is based on. Social justice divides people into groups and determines rules and regulations for those particular groups, and therefore each person in that group is only as good as what that group can achieve using those rules. In America, we have the Constitution, and that is the rule of law that dictates how all the people, every single one of us, following the same rule and regulation, was never to be treated differently. And that is the big riff. The big riff is individualism or collectivism. And unfortunately, through our fault, because people say, Karen, how did we get here? And my answer to that one is, look in the mirror, because we are the generation that did that. Unfortunately, through no fault of our own, because we were psychologically manipulated into being the silent majority, political correctness, and never talking about politics and religion. What is the most important things that happen in America? They all focus around politics and religion. But if we can't talk about them, then how will we be able to react towards them? Well, we won't talk about them, and we put the hands in the legislators who we feel will go and do the right thing. Well, they're incapable of doing the right thing because they have been trained the same way we were. And that is that the government has all the answers, and therefore they must take their clues from the government. And that's how we wound up in this mess. John Kennedy, in the 60s, when he was elected to office, ordered a report, and that report was called the Iron Mountain Report. And I suggest that everyone read it. And if you haven't read it and you want to watch it, it's a great YouTube. It's called the Iron Mountain Report. And in that report, they describe all of the secret societies that are here and that are running our government. And 10 days before he went to Dallas, JFK told the audience at Columbia University that the office, the high office of the president, has been used to foment a plot to destroy the Americans' freedom. And before I leave office, I will inform the populace of that plight. 10 days later, he was killed. These people do not play nice. There are billions of dollars at stake, and they're not going to let one person get in the way of it. Nor did they let Martin Luther King, nor did they let Bobby Kennedy, nor did they let the 200 scientists that all of a sudden died from unnatural, natural causes. People like Breitbart, people like Hastings, who was just drove his BMW, a Mercedes, into a tree, and all of a sudden this Mercedes did things that never happened before. And when a whistleblower comes to tell the people that this is going on, his government goes after him. And now he's in Russia. Isn't that amazing? How many years ago did people flee Russia to come to America? And now today, the safe being is Russia. I said both parties are the same, and both parties are the same, and we can now show you that both parties are the same because they get their marching orders from the same people. In the 1900s to the 1946-ish, the National Socialist Party, in the beginning, all of the socialist Jews, Christians, and communists had to flee Germany. Where did they come? Well, many went to Russia, and many came to the United States. And at the end of the war, many of the Nazi war criminals came to the United States. And through what was called Operation Paperclip, their identities were changed, and they were put in places like NASA and our universities and in our government. And they followed the same plan they were following in Germany. Nothing changed. What was the plan in Germany? Hitler got the farmers to turn against those evil polluter Jews who were the industrialists who were destroying the planet and should be accountable for their sins. Does that not sound familiar? That is how the environmental movement was born. Rockefeller wrote a program called The Unfinished Agenda, and that was the blueprint for Agenda 21. Carnegie went to Wilson at that time and said, I need you to extend the war. He said this in a telegram. I need you to extend the war so that we can figure out the psychological effect and how we can change the mindset of people, perhaps without using war, because war is destructive and expensive. And Carnegie focused on the school, following along with Hitler and his brown shirts, and Lenin, who said, if you give me your children, I will not have to fire a shot to take over your country. And that is exactly the two plans that they followed. And they work side by side. So when they say with Agenda 21 that it is the three E's, I say it is the four E's, because none of this works without controlling the educational system of a country. And now in America today, we no longer have education. We have indoctrination and training. And for those of you that don't know the difference between indoctrination and training and education, I might tell you that many of our legislators do not. And our Department of Education certainly does not. They brought with them a school called the Frankfurt School, and that is where they trained the people to go out into the business world and take over America. I think it was 1949, the Frankfurt School went back to Frankfurt, Germany. And in America, we have what is called today the Aspen Institute, that is a global progressive think tank funded by international globalists and George Soros, as well as Bill Gates, Eli Broad, and all of the other criminals who are pushing globalism and Agenda 21 on our people. Last week, all of our governors went to the Aspen Institute. And as a result of that, Chris Christie started demonizing the libertarians. And so did others. Where did they get that from? The Aspen Institute. Pam Bondi is a graduate of the Aspen Institute. Debbie Wasserman Schultz and Paul Ryan graduated from the same class. The parties are exactly the same. What they have done is married business through fascism, just as Andre said, and government through communism on the Democratic Party. So the Republicans are interested in fascism, and the Democrats are interested in communism. And if you remember back, why did Russia fail? Russia failed because they didn't have enough business to support it. Well, if you bring in the fascist model and you marry the two through what is called a public-private partnership, then you have a fascist police state that is controlled by a communist model. We have that today in both parties. Our real dealings with Agenda 21 started with George Bush 41, but as you can see, they all had their part. I want to read you something that I found very interesting. As we were being told that this does not exist, we were crazy. In 1994, this book appeared in our schools, and it is called Rescue Mission Planet Earth, a child's edition of Agenda 21, sponsored by the United Nations in our schools. Oh, this does not exist. Now think back. Where are the people who graduated public school and high school today? Well, they are sitting in our legislators. I want to read something to you because this one struck me really big. Think about what is going on right now. This is what the children read. Agenda 21 says, funds could be raised by reallocating resources now committed to the military. What are we doing today? Everything is planned. Nothing happens without a reason. And everything is based on lies. This book is full of all of those little nuances that just plant a seed. And eventually, when that person grows up, this is what we get. And this is why. These are some of the organizations. There's over 10,000 organizations today that are called NGOs, non-government organizations, that come from and get their marching orders from the United Nations. And they come to our communities, and they are unelected bureaucrats who will come to us as what they call stakeholders. Did anybody ever ask what a stakeholder was and who these people are and where they come from? Because a stakeholder can only benefit in a community if you lose your land. If you lose your rights, because a stakeholder only has a financial interest, and yet they get to vote on what goes on in our communities because we let them, and that is a big disaster. I'm going to skip a little bit because there's a very important slide that I want you to see. This is our education today. And this was from George Bush, 41, and Bill Clinton when he was the president of the Governor's Council. Students are human capital, and that means they are only as good as how much they can work for the state. Education's purpose is to train students to work. That is not education. We train our pets. We do not train our children. The purpose of education is to transform society from individualism to collectivism. Fact-based education, which is the truth, is no longer taught. The focus of education will be value-based. My question is, whose values? Certainly not ours. Common Core has nothing to do with children learning. It has to do with children being trained into a job function that is suitable to the government-selected business that the government will promote through a public-private partnership using regulations. How do I know that? Because I speak to people in Europe, and I got a letter, an email 3 weeks ago from a woman who said, "Don't let this happen in America. All my life, I wanted to be an engineer. I dreamed about being an engineer. In the eighth grade, I was told I have the aptitude to be a scientist. Today, I am a scientist. I hate my job." This is what we are sending our children to. We talked about this. School choice is no choice because everything will be the same. And I say to people who are running around and worrying about charter schools, what does it matter where your child learns communism if all children are going to learn communism? So school choice is a diversion. It has nothing to do with the reason why children are not learning. And there are only two reasons why children are not learning. And that is because of the content of the material that they are reading and the method, which is training. And that's why they're not learning. And we can fix everything and change every name and make the class size down to 5 people and give each child their own tutor. And if we give them the same garbage in, we will get the same garbage out. So by not paying attention to the content of the material, which is the only thing that will help a child learn, all the millions and billions of dollars that we have spent on education put us exactly in the same place. And if you look at the SAT scores and the ACT scores, you will find that over the last 30 years, the education in Florida has changed only a smidge. Nothing exciting. The only way that Florida improved its education is when somebody changed the grades and dropped them like Robinson did last year or like Bennett wanted to do this year. There is no progress in education because they're not learning anything. Sustainable developments, look at the bottom 7 counties. The minute you start sustainable developments, the demographics change. Why does that happen? Because every sustainable development has to have a proportion of low, mid, and upper income people. Them thinking we're all going to live in the same place. Isn't that exciting? It never happens that way. And after visiting Louisiana and going to some of their sustainable communities, what we discovered was rows and rows and rows of empty houses that we, the people, are paying for. While 3 or 4 of the homes, of the apartments, I would say, because they were skinny little side-by-side duplexes, maybe we walked on one block out of 24 homes, there were 3 families. Why? Because the minute you move in, the lower income people, the middle income people, and the upper income people, they don't want to live there. They don't want to give up their 2,400 square foot house to live in a 700 square foot apartment. And these people think we're going to do that. And they think we're going to do that real excited. And so they're going to continue to build this, and this is how they intend to take over the country and turn the country blue. Because all of those illegals will then have to go and live someplace, and that will be in the sustainable developments. Florida up here, everything that's red and yellow and green is off limits to humans. So what Governor Scott is doing in every one of his little sustainability programs that he gives a nice little name to, they're all part of the same program. So what he's essentially doing is giving everybody a little piece of a jigsaw puzzle without telling everybody that eventually that jigsaw puzzle will be put together and Florida will be gutted and off limits to human beings, because that's what happens. The Everglades was a national park owned and controlled by the United Nations. What's going on in the Everglades now? Oh, humans will always be able to go there. Yellowstone, same thing. Humans will always be able to go there. They can coexist with the animals. Until last week, when in the paper it said, the airboats are making too much noise. They are disturbing the fish. So therefore, airboats cannot go in to the Everglades anymore, making the Everglades off limits to human beings. That is the goal. Yellowstone National Park, owned and controlled, we thought, by America. Oh no, part of the World Heritage Program, now controlled by the United Nations. 124 parks and recreation centers are part of the World Heritage Organization, which is controlled by the United Nations. Take a look at this. Conservation. I was going to show you this one first. We have a minute. Take a look at Broward County. 62% of Broward County is already under some conservation program. Look at Miami-Dade. 65% of Miami-Dade is under some conservation program. I lived in Broward County. Broward County has one of the highest tax rates in the United States. Why? Because every time land goes into conservation, it gets taken off the tax rolls. So it's a neat little game that's played. They come to your land, they want your land, they'll make up a story, whether it is wetlands, wildlands, or an endangered species, or some kind of water event, they will get your land. They will entice you with conservation easements, or just force you off your land under eminent domain. But now they're not paying. It says that if America must appropriate property and it belongs to an individual, they must be paid for that land. 1,400 people were forced off their property in an 8.5 square mile area in the Everglades by DERM, which is the Department of Environmental Management, just walking onto their property and saying, you are in a wetlands and you must take everything off your property, including your nursery, your farm, your animals, your barn, everything down to the bare earth. You can live there, but you can't do anything with your land. And now you can't even live there. This is coming here, and we have to be very, very aware of it, because our county commissioners are saying, yay, 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 give us the Restore Act money, give us that grant money, without looking at the strings that are attached to it. And we have to be wary of the strings, because their goal is to push us into these communities. And they're very patient, and in reality, they're going to wait for us to die off. And they tell the children in school, they tell the human capital, don't talk to your parents, don't talk to your grandparents, they don't know anything. The school will help you, the school will tell you. That's old school what they do. Their stuff is old, you want new. Why are they saying that? Because we know history, and history has been changed in their books. So we have to pay attention to what they're reading and what they are writing. They want our private property, and the Florida legislature did a wonderful job of that this year by passing HB 87 and giving back the same criminal banks, the special interest banks, who robbed us blind and destroyed our housing market and our economy, the ability to just say, I have the documents, they're in my office, I didn't bring them with me, I'm sorry. You lose your property. That's what 87 will do. And that was passed. The room was filled with people. The people said no. The special interests said yes. How many legislators ran unopposed and felt they didn't have to answer to anybody? That's why paying attention to elections is so important. I want to go over something with you, which many of you know about Agenda 21. All of our information is on agenda21today.com. It's time for action. And I want to read something to you from a textbook. This was from C-Scope. Somebody, a woman that I work with in Texas, sent it to me. When Texas said no to Common Core, Obama brought in C-Scope. And she sent me this because this is an online lesson, and this is why online lesson plans and lessons are so dangerous. The slide says, this was all about population. They never explained once through the entire lesson, and they never compared population to landmass. But they show pictures of crowded areas. Today, if we took all the people, all the families in the United States, and gave every family a quarter of an acre to live on, we would all fit in the state of Ohio. So how is America overcrowded? It isn't, because it's a lie. It's harder to control 6 billion people than it is to control 1 billion people. So what does this slide say? It says, population concerns. Too many people, not enough resources, food, water, space, massive disease, poor quality of life. The next slide is a picture of people, and the caption says, "Time for them to die." And this is what the high schoolers are reading in school. Folks, nothing is more important than finding out what your human capital are reading. And I now use the word human capital to make a point, because that's what they feel about our children. And that is wrong. And unless we use the words that they use, they will ignore us. So that is a very important thing that we should be doing. One of the things that I do is I have made my own rule. And I said that I will talk to at least 5 new people a week. And I'm doing that because right now we are at a crisis situation. And there are so many topics, we don't have to be nasty and political. As long as we can find a topic that we can communicate with, we can break down the barrier and start communicating. Look at this room. Look who's not here. Where are the other people that feel like we do, but also have been told through the years, don't go to the tea parties, they hate you. They are terrorists. They hate America. They will destroy you. And they don't show up. We have to go to them. It's very, very important that we open up the lines of communication with our neighbors, with our friends, with our families, with churches, with communities and organizations. So I am asking each of you to do what I am doing, what I'm about to describe, and that is the crisis that we have in America is that our people cannot read. You cannot solve anything, and you will be forever a slave if you cannot read. You are always left to the interpretation of someone else. Well, it's really tough to go over to somebody and say, hey, can you read? They're not going to answer you. They'll be embarrassed. But the other thing that did happen was, remember back to the Zimmerman trial? Oh, my God, she's not going to talk about that again. Yes, I am, but differently. Because when Rachel Gentel said on under oath, I cannot read, sir. I cannot read and write cursive writing. She is a result of No Child Left Behind. Thank you, Jeb Bush. Her generation and generations before her and generations after her cannot read and write cursive writing. So it is easier for us to approach them on that angle than it is to say, can you read? What we can do is go to our communities, go to our churches, go to other churches, and make an offer to help anyone learn to read and write cursive writing. Why is cursive writing important? Cursive writing does 3 things. 1, in a young child, it's very important for eye-hand coordination. 2, it is the identifier of you, the individual. It is your signature. It is your personal handwriting. And when your personal handwriting is the same as everyone else, you feel powerless. We have to bring back individuality. And we can do that by redoing the thing that has been taken away. And lastly, and most important, our founding documents are written in cursive writing. So if we want our children to inherit a country that they understand, how will they understand it if they cannot read and write cursive writing? I'm asking all of the groups that I work with in the month of August to do an initiative to teach anyone who is receptive, put an ad in your paper, offer classes, go to the library, begin to teach cursive writing. Because from that, you can talk, you can communicate, you can get respect and trust as an individual, not as a group. Because as a group, That's what they're used to. We have to be individuals. And the only way we can break down the race barrier is by being an individual. My next door neighbor was black. And when all of this started, I spoke to him and I asked him if he thought that I was a racist. And he said, no, we're friends. You come to my house, I go to your house. We share things. Why would I ever think that? And I said, I belong to a Tea Party. And I just heard that we were racist and terrorists. Do you think I would belong to an organization that was racist and terrorist? And he said, no, Karen, I know you. And that's what stuck. I know you. They don't know us. They know a group, because that's what collectivism is. That's what communism is. The individual is not important. You are only as good as your group. You must be equal to your group. You cannot stand out and be an individual. And we can't bring back individualism as a group. It won't work. But we can start by being individuals to our neighbors. And once you start that relationship, you will gain the respect of your neighbors. And then you can start having conversations. And remember that September, we have Constitution Day. Aren't we lucky? Every day should be Constitution Day. But what a wonderful thing to be able to teach people and end up in September reading the original Constitution with the people that you taught. So that's my project. And that is something that I think that we as individuals can do. And I think that it is something that we can bring back, because that relationship is worth more than anything that you can imagine. And that relationship can never be bought. And guess what will happen when it comes time for an election or for an important item to be issued? Who will those people turn to? They will come to you. And they might say, how should I vote for that adjustment? How should I vote? And you can have a conversation with them. And that's what we need to get back to. The other thing that I'm asking is, when you go to the Common Core meetings, tell them you want a test model. Because if we say, we want you to get rid of Common Core, they will bring back the same program, repackaged, real nice, and they'll say, here's your new program, Apple Core. And you know what? It's the same program, because the programs have not changed. From year after year after year, they are the same. They are indoctrination. They are teaching our children to hate their parents, hate God, and hate their country. The goal of education today is to change the family to school, change God to government, and change America to the United Nations. And you heard Andre say that. So this is not something that is now under the rug. And so I want to thank you all for listening to me this evening. It's been a pleasure, and I'm sure that you have lots of questions, and I will be happy to answer them. But remember, victory is our only option, and we have a very, very short window to make it happen. But we will, when we work together, because united, we will never fail. Thank you.
How does that affect the AP classes?
Every class will be teaching the same thing at the same time. If they had their way, school in America would be 10 o'clock Tuesday morning, every fifth grade class is on page 10 in math. That's what they're looking for. So it doesn't matter. They're gonna call them AP, because while they're typing on their computer, which is what we want to get rid of, and in a lot of areas we don't have the bandwidth to support it, so we don't want to make, we want to make sure we don't have the bandwidth to support it. But when they type on the computer, They have algorithms that have been put into the computer. So if I answer something one way, my next question is going to move in that direction. If you answer something one way, your next question will move you in a different direction. Because early on, they're going to decide what job and slot you're going to go into. So you're going to be nudged along into that job and slot. It starts in pre-K. Communists believe cradle-to-grave education, get the kid away from the family, because the family provides morals. And a moral society would never allow the garbage that is in school, which is the next step that we should look at. Every social program that is in school takes away from a child's being able to read, write, do math. They're busy learning how to have sex, how to be bullies, how to do drugs. This is what they're learning in school. How can I say that? Because what are they telling them? Here's condoms, don't do sex. What are the kids going to do? Go out and have sex. Then what are they going to do? Come back to us and say, teenage pregnancies are up. We need a new program. We need to get more money. We have to have another group forming to help the teens that are pregnant. Stop teaching them in school. We taught reproductive biology. My parents talked to me about sex. It does not belong in school. When you teach a kid not to do drugs, but you're telling them, use a clean needle, what are they going to do? Go out and do drugs. This is what we are nudging our kids to because we're only teaching them emotional things. We have a right brain, left brain going on here, and the right brain is not connecting to the left brain because the fact, the logic, and reason is not being utilized. The emotion is being utilized. So we have high-strung, emotional kids who will see something on TV and then go and react to what they just saw. And they'll go out and be a mob or whatever it is because they're triggered and told by what the messaging is on TV. So you should also take a look at their books and pick apart something. You could take any one of their books and dispel anything, especially the science books, because it's full of global warming, and that, we all know, is not going to happen. So what you've got to do is pick something that's not confrontational and never make bold statements. Always ask bold questions. Blah, 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 blah. I read that. Do you think that's right? How do you feel? So this way you're getting from them. You're not imposing your, you can turn it around. That's what we have to, as he said, you learn by what they are doing and use the same thing. Use the same tactic. They use what's called the Hegelian dialectic. Crisis, scream, control. Very simple. Create the crisis, create the scream, and we'll control you. NSA was a perfect example. Yeah?
Fox News drives me crazy with how do you feel, not what do you think?
Because Fox News is owned by the Saudis.
That's right.
Really?
Yes. Yeah. You have to go back now. What really you should do is go back now and take a look at all of the organizations. That's why they are so international, international, international. That's why they're doing that, because all of our books that we now know are Islamic biased, which we've known for the last 3 years, but thank God they're beginning to talk about it. Why? Because Pearson is owned by Saudi Arabia, Kuwait, and the United Arab Emirates, aside from everybody else. But the Saudi king is the one that writes the check. So our books are Islamic biased. What a surprise. Our networks on TV, in print. Why are we doing a newspaper? Because the newspapers are owned by the international globalists, mostly part of the International Monetary Fund, the same group. International Monetary Fund, the World Bank, they're all owned by the same people. And their programs work the same way. They get you to believe that in order to save the planet, you've got to give up everything. And then they lend the dictators money. Think about this. The United Nations, 1946. the United Nations. How many billions, probably trillions of dollars, have the Americans given to the United Nations in the last 60 years? Why do we still have poverty? You don't have to be a rocket scientist to figure that one out. $2 billion we gave to the United Nations for Haiti. Where did it go? Bill Clinton, George Bush. Certainly never got to the people in Haiti. We've got to say no. We've got to say stop. And those are the things where we come in. But when you have the evidence and you can say, wait a minute, Common Core, where are the, who's going to benefit? Bill Gates, what a surprise. Murdoch, who else? Jeb Bush, why? Because his brother Neil has the software company called Ignite that made a fortune out of No Child Left Behind. Do you think he's going to leave him behind for Common Core? I don't think so. We have to look and follow the money. This is not idea-driven. This is money-driven. And if you want to know what is behind anything that you're experiencing, follow the money. Because the money will dictate. And what you're going to find? The same people over and over and over again. In the land, they do a really neat thing. I want this piece of property. Okay, I'm going to ask you, you're going to sell it? I don't want to sell it. I'll make it so annoying for you. Okay, I'll sell it. I'm going to create a trust of you four people. And you four people are going to buy his property. Now you got it in a trust. It's off the tax rolls. The people don't have it. And let's say your property was $100,000. And you sold it to them for $100,000 because that was the appraised value. The trust will sell it to Florida Forever for $300,000 because it's our money and they could care less. In Putnam County, they just, Florida Forever last year, we begged Jeff Atwater not to give Florida Forever money. He did. They bought an $800,000 appraised piece of property for $2.3 million of our tax dollars. And this goes on over and over and over again, unless we put a stop to it. And the only way we're going to put a stop to it is to elect the right people and ask them the right questions. And we can't listen to them. I don't care what they say. I don't care what they think. I want to know if they're going to listen to the people. Because if they're not going to listen to us, then I know what's going to happen when they get to Tallahassee. And I'm focused on Tallahassee because, as you heard, Andre, it is local that is important. We can't fix Washington right now unless we got rid of every person that was there, which is what should be done. I don't care who they are. There's maybe five that I would leave out of all of them that are there. The rest of them belong under the bus, under the train that they're... And in Florida, same thing. Rick Scott, look what he's doing. He's giving every conservation group everything he can. We said, no rail, no rail, no rail. Guess what we just got? SunRail. Guess who's doing it? The Florida companies? No. An American company? No. Siemens from Germany is building our rail. How smart is that? But that's only one piece. Because then after that, they create a free zone. And then they all go live there. And in Idaho, they have a Chinese city. They're building a Chinese city that is autonomous to China. Chinese rules and Chinese regulations will be followed in that city. We have 37 Muslim strongholds in America that we cannot step foot on because they follow Muslim law in America. In America, that's going on. And what did Rick Scott do? He took $30 million to create a communist Chinese charter school. Communist Chinese charter school in South Florida. What on earth are these people thinking? And that's our fault, our fault. We have a commissioner of agriculture. I'm driving up and down the panhandle, and all I'm seeing is empty farm, empty farm, empty farm, empty farm. Food prices going up and up and up and up and up. Where are we getting our food from? Guatemala, Mexico, South America, every place but America. Why? Because our farmers are not farming. Why are they not farming? Because Adam Putnam got paid off by the ethanol growers, so those people are growing corn, and then the EPA and the FDA gave so many regulations to the farmers that I spoke to one farmer, and he said, it will cost me $25,000 a year just to bring my produce to Walmart. He said, do you have any idea how much I have to sell to get $25,000 for that license? Another farmer told me, I can't take the produce off my farm. They told me they won't let the distribution truck on my farm because it may have bacteria. In Georgia, they're putting meters on the water, on private wells on farms. And we have smart meters which are going to dictate the day and time and usage that we will be allowed to use our appliances. And you heard Obama. What did he say? Oh, if you think, when this is when he was in Africa, if you think that all you children that are here are going to have big cars and big houses and air conditioning, the earth will boil over. You won't be able to have that. So what am I going to do for you? I'm going to give you $7 billion so you can go develop fossil fuels. What? $7 billion and we have 4 out of 5 Americans that are on government assistance. 4 out of 5 Americans. In the meantime, $7 billion is going to South Africa. I have a friend that works in the oil business. He said he goes on the rig, he takes out his binoculars, and he looks 15 miles down the Gulf, and he sees all of the rigs in Mexican waters. They are drilling for Mexico. How did they get there? We gave them a $2.5 billion loan to drill in the same place where we can't. And our legislators are doing nothing. Nothing. Are there any other questions? Yes?
One observation. Number one, thank you for your time and your foresight. You're fantastic.
Thank you.
I've subbed at the Choctaw High School for 9 years, okay? Cursive writing is now being taught in high school.
I know.
I now teach in elementary school. Cursive writing is not being taught.
No.
I asked the principal why. She says there's no need because we have computers.
Exactly. And ask her what does she do when the lights go out. What do we do in the middle of a storm? We had Wilma, 3.5 weeks of no electricity. Computers are really great then. That's what we really should do with our families and our grandkids is have them come and shut off the lights. What do you do? What do you do? People said to me, Karen, how do I know what I'm going to do in, you know, if there's a crisis? Because I always tell everybody, prepare. Prepare, prepare, prepare. Prepare like it's a long hurricane. Oh, I don't know what to do. Oh, it's real easy. Friday night, turn off the lights and don't turn them on until Monday morning. Don't use electricity. See what you need. You'll figure out real fast. You can make it a game with your grandkids. But there's another thing that you can do when you're teaching them cursive writing. Sit with some device. Have them explain it to you. And then go use it to find conservative documents, conservative things. Because they're going to teach you. But you pre-plan the website that you want them to teach you how to get to. And you can make a whole lesson out of that. But if we don't get back and start teaching our kids cursive writing, we can guarantee that there will be no America. And that is a guarantee. Yes?
Karen, before you started your dissertation tonight, you brought up a point about the Agenda 21 and them coming in and planting animals in a certain area and things like that. There was a very strange article in our newspaper here this weekend or 2 days ago or something like that. All of a sudden, these mysterious turtles showed up in a local park with silver on their back, and then signs started appearing, don't harm the animals.
Right.
Is this part of that movement of let's get...
This is what they do, yes. So what did they do? They built a turtle tunnel. Isn't that nice? I sent Bill Nelson a letter, and I asked him when he was going to carry the stop and go sign and what monitor he was going to put by the turtle tunnel. $1.4 million we spent on a turtle tunnel. $100 million we spent on a bridge to nowhere in the Everglades where now we can't go. $100 million. They had to raise the entire highway so that grass would be able to grow under the highway because they were worried about the grass. A judge begged them and said this is a supreme waste of taxpayer money. And there you have Bill Nelson and Charlie Crist signing the check. Isn't that wonderful? We have to stop programs like this that make no sense and are built on lies. Just because it's money, we have to get our heads out of that framework and put it into, is it constitutional? Will we get a return on investment? And is it scientifically sound? Because none of these programs have any science behind them. The goal of these programs are to constrict human beings and to make sure that it is overly expensive. None of their programs have any financial data in them at all. And listen to what he said. Just trust us. Just trust us. You don't have to come to the meetings. We don't need you to show up. Just trust us. I don't think so. Go there and ask the right questions. Which one of you lives in the community? You won't get an answer. How much is this going to cost? Don't worry, it's a grant. Well, what happens when the grant is over? Oh, don't worry about that. That's down the road. You don't have to think about that. That's the wrong answer, folks. The wrong answer. And then I always like to ask them what science is behind that, because then they really go bonkers. Because the science they have created, they created on their computers. And they use what they call consensus science. So they have a room full of scientists like that who all have grants, whose all income and livelihood depends on that grant, and they say, this is the outcome we want you to achieve. Now you take your little computers and you write up a program to get me that outcome. The problem is the outcome doesn't exist, and the only way that you can get there is to lie and make up things. So they lie and make up things. And then they come to us and they say, man-made global warming. Think about that. And what did they pick on? CO2. Why did they pick on CO2? Because plants need CO2 in order to produce food. And if we don't have food, we will depopulate the planet. So that's their plan. So they'll tax us because they don't want us to use CO2, because their real goal is to depopulate the planet. And controlling food is the way to do it. And I hate to tell them that one of their little wildfires puts more CO2 in the atmosphere than all of us humans could do in a 4-year span. So that one doesn't hold either. We've got to be very definitive, go back to them with facts, because the truth doesn't lie, and they have no answer for the truth. And yes, sir.
Ma'am, regarding the conservation programs, when dealing with programs like the National Park Service, and I guess around here we would be answering to the military since they own the rangelands around here, which at the moment they're letting us use still, and they're being quite fair about it, but who would we go to address or fight these conservation programs on a federal level?
On a federal level, we have to go to the committee that's behind it. So we have now John Casey, that many of you have met. He was asked to finally We have a group that's actually suing the EPA for giving out erroneous information. And those are the things that we can do. And through organizations like this, when we say, pick up the phone and call Tallahassee and tell them this, that's what we mean. That's how we got rid of Bennett. Pick up the phone and call Jeff Miller and tell him this. And then when he doesn't do it, tell him again, because he has a habit of not listening to us, a very bad habit of not listening. So emails, calls, but the committee people. And when you get to the committee people or any people, when you're dealing with them, make a friend of somebody, of a staffer who works in the office. Because a large time, what happens is the information goes to the staffer first. And if they don't like it, it never gets where it's supposed to be. So you want to make sure that the information goes there. And stop elevating legislators to where they don't belong. I call them by their first name. They work for me. I do not work for them. I am not giving anybody a title because they don't deserve it. They don't represent us, so they can't be representatives. So I do that also. We have to start taking back, and we can, little by little by little, by stop being politically correct, by stop being the silent majority, and by talking about politics and religion. But going to meetings like this is wonderful, but we have to share them, and that's what's important. And we're not going to do that unless we can make a friend of somebody from a different mindset. And no matter what they say and no matter how they try to skew it, the ratio for the people who are upset in America has never changed. 70 to 80% of the people are disgusted. So that means we've got a big audience that we can talk on some level. And all you have to do is find the level that you can communicate, that you agree, and then you expand it. Because once you agree, you can talk about things that you don't disagree. But you got to find common ground first, and that's very important. Yes?
Hans, you're the first person I've ever heard speak about globalization. And the first, I'll say, government official I ever heard use the term one world order was George Bush, number 41.
Right.
That was the first place time I'd ever heard this. Now, I have just finished reading a book called Brotherhood of Darkness.
Oh, okay.
And you would be amazed how many, I mean, names like you mentioned, Carnegie, Rockefeller, Wilson, President Wilson, and even people today who are in prominent places belong to these societies, and that's their goal. We will have the rich, and we will have the super poor.
Leveling the playing field does not mean bringing everybody up to American standards. It means bringing Americans down to third world standards. So let's describe what that means. So now you hear leveling the playing field. To you, it means one thing. To me, it means something else. So now the other thing that I do when I talk to people is I define the words in advance. If we're going to talk about immigration, then I would say we are talking about illegal immigration, period. So that you define the words, because they have a nice way of mixing them all together so that you can never figure out what you're saying. And by the end of the conversation, you're not talking to each other. And that's their goal, because you'll be separated and divided and you won't have a way to talk. They've done that with the word globalization. It used to be we were in the international market, the international job market, the international economic market. International means an autonomous sovereign nation deals with another autonomous sovereign nation. So we would deal with Mexico, Brazil, whatever, doesn't matter. Globalization means there are no nations. Everything is divided up into regions, and a bureaucrat heads the region and tells you what to do. And in our country, we have Richard Nixon to thank for that, because he divided America into the Agenda 21 regions that were called for in Rockefeller's plan, which now became this. So this is not a new thing. And we have to recognize what it is, but learning the words, learning the vernacular, and doing the right things, and being in contact is what's most important. That's really the key. Thank you all.